بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين أما بعد اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا كريم In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most beneficent, the most merciful. All praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who made the sacred house a meeting place and a secure sanctuary for mankind. And all praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who made the standing place of Ibrahim alayhi salam whilst he built the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a place of prayer. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we seek His assistance and we seek His guidance and we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evils of our souls and the adverse consequences of our deeds. Whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees guidance upon, then none can misguide that person. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees misguidance upon, then none can guide him. And peace and salutations be upon the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I bear witness that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his final messenger. My dear brothers and sisters and mothers and fathers, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I welcome you all to our second program together in our Fanar Qatar series, and this talk is titled Lessons from the Life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our time together sincere worship and a means of beautifying our paradise. Ameen. Ameen. We've always reminded each other during previous sittings how our coming together should not be for anything else or anyone else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For sitting such as these are indeed the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And anything which is considered worship must have ikhlas and sincerity. For this is the greatest pillar from the pillars of worship. My dear brothers and sisters, yesterday we discussed the lessons for the resident during the best days of the year, the first 10 days of the Hijjah. And we shared together certain realities related to these days and advices that if followed can be a means of us resurrecting these days and constructing these days in an active and proactive manner, in a way that breeds magnanimous benefit in our lives. And we shared many types of worship that we should engage in. And one of the things we forgot to say, which is something well known, is the recitation of the Qur'an. The recitation of the Qur'an. Reciting the Qur'an should definitely be a major feature during these days, as it should be a feature in our lives during every day of our lives. A Muslim should never go to bed except that they have a portion from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they complete daily. If they do not complete that portion, they should not go to sleep. Right? A Muslim should ensure that they have this daily relationship with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as was the practice of the Salaf al-Salih, of the pious predecessors before us. Right? And when I say a portion, I mean a portion that we consider a rock in our daily timetable. A rock means that which can never be changed. Whether we're traveling, irrespective of circumstance, it's something that exists in our day, just as we have the five daily salawat. The five daily salawat. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted a great reward for the recitation of His book. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us that a person who reads the Quran, then they benefit from their recitation by earning a hasana for every letter recited. For every letter recited. And a hasana is equal to 10. A hasana is equal to 10. So if you say alif, la, meem, then this equals 30 rewards. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Such an easy way to gain magnanimous rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this again is testimony to the amazing reward system of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kareem. That we practice a little and He rewards us with a lot. And we touched on this point yesterday. Walillahi alhamd. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspire diligence amongst us during the course of our lives. Ameen. And during the special 10 days that are about to visit us very soon. Ameen. I don't think there's long to go. It's probably tomorrow or the day after. I'm not too sure of the exact sightings here in Qatar and when you will look for the moon for the month of Dhul-Hijjah. But I'm sure it's in the next 3 or 4 days this great visitor will visit us, and that is the first 10 days of the Hijjah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. Ameen. O servants of Allah and O children of Adam, today we aim at discussing certain points from the life of a giant that walked this earth before us. That walked this earth before us. And he was a giant in every form and meaning of the word. He was a giant in terms of his tawheed. And a giant in terms of his da'wah. And a giant in terms of his action. And a giant in terms of his character. And a giant in terms of his achievements. And a giant in terms of his submission. And a giant in terms of his wisdom. And a man who earned an amazing title. The title of Khalilullah. An amazing title that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never granted to any other prophet besides Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So a title in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never gave anyone besides Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is well known, my dear brothers and sisters, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates what He wants, when He wants. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He grants a special precedence to whom and what He wills. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, the nourisher, the sustainer, the King of kings, the Lord of the worlds. Everything in creation is answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not answerable to anybody. Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, Al-Wahid al-Qahhar, Al-Ahad, Al-Fard al-Samad, Al-Ladhi lam yalid wa lam yulad, wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And with this understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we just said, He creates what He wills, when He wants, and provides a certain precedence to what He wishes. Just like this, He created the months of the year. He created the months of the year. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted a special precedence to one month in the year, the month of Ramadan. A month that is considered the head of all the months of the year. For Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Sayyidu shuhur shahr Ramadan. That the head of all the months of the year is the month of Ramadan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created all the days of the year. And He granted and gave a special precedence to the first 10 days of the Hijjah. And he created the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. And he gave a special precedence to the day of Arafah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the nights of the year. And he gave a special precedence to the last 10 nights during the month of Ramadan. And he created the last 10 nights during the month of Ramadan and gave a special precedence to the night of power. Laylatul Qadr, khayrun min alf shahr. A month which is better than 1,000 months. And just like this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the weeks of the year and created the days of the week. And he gave a special precedence to the day of Jumu'ah, the day that we just witnessed today, the best day upon which the sun rises. And during the Jumu'ah khutbah, we shared an amazing hadith that magnifies the importance of this day, the day of Jumu'ah, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indeed has given it a special precedence. For as we discussed, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in a hadith which is sahih, أَفْضَلُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسِ يَوْمْ الْجُمُعَةِ. That the best day upon which the sun rises is the day of Jumu'ah. فِيهِ خُلِقَ آدَمْ. On this day Allah created Adam alayhi salam. وَفِيهِ أُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ. And on this day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entered him into paradise. وَفِيهِ أُخْرِجَ مِنْهَا. And on this day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed him from paradise. وَلَا تَقُومُ السَّاعَةَ إِلَّا فِي يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ. And the coming of the final hour will not happen except on the day of Jumu'ah. On the day of Jumu'ah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the days of the week and He gave a special precedence to the day of Jumu'ah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as He has created time, He has created place. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created place and gave a special precedence to some lands over other lands, to some countries over other countries, to some places over other places. Thus, He gave a special precedence to Mecca, Makkatul Mukarramah. And He gave a special precedence to Medina, Al-Madinah Al-Munawwarah. And He gave a special precedence to Sham. To Sham, the blessed lands, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Sham in His book. Allahu Akbar. And just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created time and gave a special precedence to certain aspects over others and created places and gave a special precedence to those places over others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the angels. And He gave the angels a special precedence within the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave a special precedence to some angels over others. To some angels over others. Thus, He gave a special honor and rank to Jibreel alayhi salam, and Mikael alayhi salam, and Israfil alayhi salam. And out of these three angels, He chose as the head and gave a special precedence to Jibreel alayhi salam. And just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the angels, He created mankind. He created mankind that began with Adam alayhi salam, Abu al-Bashar, the father of mankind. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within mankind gave a special precedence and rank and honor to some of mankind over others. Thus, He chose His prophets, alayhim as-salatu was-salam, and He gave them rank and honor over the rest of mankind. And just as He chose His prophets, from them He chose specific prophets and gave them a special precedence and rank and honor over the other prophets. And these prophets are known as Ulul Azmi min al-Rusul, the prophets of absolute resolution. Nuh alayhi salam, and Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Musa alayhi salam, and Isa alayhi salam, and Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave these prophets a special precedence and a special rank over all the other prophets. And as Allah gave a special rank and special precedence to these ulul azmi min ar-rusul, these prophets of absolute resolution, from them Allah gave a special precedence and rank to a group of them over others. Thus He chose Ibrahim alayhi salam, and He chose Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and gave them a special station, the station of Khalil, and He named them and gave them the title of Khalilullah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ibrahim alayhi salam. And from them too, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a special rank and a special precedence and a special honor to one. And He is our beloved Prophet, the one who we desire to meet in the hereafter, the one whom we've loved for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, huwa Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, walillahi alhamd. Wallahu yakhluqu ma yasha'u wa yakhtar. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in His book, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates what He wants, and He chooses from them who He wants. Ma kana lahum al-khiyara. No one has any inclusion in this process when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives honor and rank. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah Almighty, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, gather us with those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a special rank and honor and precedence to in Jannah. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon all able. Ameen. Ameen. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, we had to have this introduction to understand the rank of Ibrahim alayhi salam and what will make us understand who he was alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam, who Allah has given placement in the seventh heaven. In the seventh heaven, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was taken to the heavens during the night of Isra and Mi'raj. Isra refers to the travel by night, the travel from Mecca to Bayt al-Maqdis. And then the Mi'raj, which is the ascension, right? Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought His beloved to the heavens. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam traversed through the heavens. Traversed through the heavens. And we know that he met different prophets, different anbiya alayhimu salatu wa salam, in different heavens. So he met Yusuf alayhi salam in the third heaven. And he said that Yusuf alayhi salam had half of all beauty. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So Allah created beauty and He gave us beauty and He gave a special precedence and rank with regards to this beauty to who He wished. And that was Yusuf alayhi salam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he continued his journey and he reached the seventh heaven, he saw in that heaven Ibrahim alayhi salam. And by Allah, Allah has given this man a special rank and a special honor. And inshallah we will appreciate this today, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Ibrahim alayhi salam, my dear brothers and sisters, was born in what we call in the Arabic language, Babel, or in English, Babylon, a place that exists in Iraq. And he was born during the reign of a tyrant, oppressor, and disbeliever, Namrud. He was born during the reign of Namrud, and a time when ignorance was strife. And yesterday we discussed the ignorance at the time of Jahiliyyah, right? At the time before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a prophet. And this is the similarity between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ibrahim alayhi salam. They were born at a time when ignorance was at unprecedented levels. And the ruler of this place was one who was filled with misguidance to such an extent that he termed himself the Lord. He termed himself the Lord. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the third juz, He mentions to us a debate which Ibrahim alayhi salam conducted with this evil tyrant. He debated him to make him understand that he is no Lord, but it is the creator of the heavens and the earth who is the Lord. And in the third juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us,
أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِي حَاجَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ فِي رَبِّهِ أَنْ آتَاهُ اللَّهُ الْمُلْكِ إِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّيَ الَّذِي يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ قَالَ أَنَا أُحْيِي وَأُمِيتُ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْتِي بِالشَّمْسِ مِنَ الْمَشْرِقِ فَأْتِ بِهَا مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرَ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have you not looked at him who disputed with Ibrahim alayhi salam, or in the English language, Abraham, about his Lord Allah, because Allah had given him the kingdom. Allah had given Namrud the kingdom. So he was deceived by this gift. And this should make us more fearful, O servants of Allah. That when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us and gives us and gives us, we should be thankful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and never ever take it for granted. Whenever Allah blesses us with a gift, let that gift be a reason for us to contemplate and benchmark ourselves with the ideals. And let us see whether we are close to those ideals or upon those ideals. Let it not be a case where we engage in sin and misguidance, and Allah gives us and gives us, thus we feel safe from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For understand, O servant of Allah, and O child of Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَأَمِنُوا مَكْرَ اللَّهِ. Do they feel safe from the punishment of Allah? Do they feel safe from the punishment of Allah? Allah says, فَلَا يَأْمَنُوا مَكْرَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمِ الْخَاسِرُونَ. That no one feels safe from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except the losers. Except the losers. Thus always take stock of yourself and your day and your week, because Allah has blessed us with gifts. The gifts of eyesight and hearing and life and financial standing and material well-being according to our level, as based upon the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us all this. But don't take it for granted. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these gifts do not become a means of increased punishment. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about certain tyrants and disbelievers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about them, سَنَسْتَدْرِجُهُمْ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. They will be given and given only so that the punishment can be even more severe. Allahu al-musta'an. Allahu al-musta'an. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Namrud a kingdom and he disbelieved. And in retrospect, we have the lesson of Sulaiman alayhi salam. And what kingdom did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give Sulaiman? Allahu Akbar. Where the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was placed under the control of Sulaiman alayhi salam. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. It was placed under his control. And he says that this is from the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon me, to test me. Will I be from those who are thankful, or will I be from those who disbelieve? La ilaha illallah. Look at the understanding of this Prophet. لِيَبْلُوَنِي, to test me. Will I be from the thankful and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or will I be from amongst those who are ungrateful And being ungrateful is a type of kufr. Is a type of kufr. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ If you are thankful, لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ Allah will increase for you. And we should aim increase. It shouldn't be a case whereby Allah rewards us for all our good in this dunya. And when we get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we find nothing. Because Allah is just. He will reward us for our good. But a believer wants reward in this world and a greater reward in the hereafter. Because we don't live for the temporary. Rather, we live for the perpetual. And remember, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in His book,
وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا
Allahu Musta'an. Allah says that we advanced them in terms of their rewards. We gave them an advance. We rewarded them in the temporary. So when they reached the perpetual, they found nothing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala besides scattered dust. They found nothing. They were hoping they would see mountains of rewards, but rather they found scattered dust. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewarded them for their good whilst they lived the life of this world. And we don't want that. We don't want that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ If you are thankful, لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ Allah will increase for you. And in retrospect, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَإِن كَفَرْتُمْ كُفْر إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ If you are ungrateful, this is a type of kufr. The punishment of Allah is severe. And remember, kufr or kafara refers to covering something. Something which is covered. Right? So you hide your belief with disbelief. And you hide your gratitude with being ungrateful. This is a type of kufr. In Qatar, I'm sure when you purchase a tire, a car tire, what do they call it? Right? We're laughing, right? This is Arabic language, right? They call it a kafara because it's something that covers the rim of the vehicle. Right, so something which covers. And that's why even the farmers were known linguistically as kuffar. Right, not meaning that they have disbelieved, but kuffar in that they hide the seed under soil. So it's hidden. The seed that's meant to grow is hidden with soil. So this is what kafara means, or kufr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَئِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِ لَشَدِيدٌ That if you are ungrateful, and cover your gratitude with ungratefulness, then the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is severe. So Allah says, because Allah had given him the kingdom, meaning Namrud, he disbelieved because Allah gave him the kingdom. He thought he was Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when Ibrahim said to him, my Lord, meaning Allah, is he who gives life and causes death. Gives life and causes death. So Namrud responded in this debate and said, I also give life and cause death. Right? In his own understanding, if he freed someone from prison, this was life given to them. And if he slayed somebody, he considered himself as having given them death. And look at the intellect of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Look at the suratul badiha, as they call it. Right? His ability to think on his feet, as we say in the English language. Ibrahim alayhi salam saw how shallow this person was in his understanding. So Ibrahim alayhi salam said, verily, my Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brings the sun from the east. So you bring it from the west. If you are who you say you are, my Allah brings it from the east. فَأْتِ بِهَا مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ So bring it from the west. فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرَ And he defeated his opposition. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so the disbeliever, meaning Namrud, was utterly defeated. And Allah guides not the people who are the oppressors, the wrongdoers. This is Ibrahim alayhi salam. Wallahi, how in touch was he with his natural disposition? With his natural disposition, this tawheed. Because again, he was similar to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or he came before. So we say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was similar to him. But in terms of our discussion with Ibrahim, he grew up in a household of shirk, where they worshipped idols. And a community that worshipped idols. And a community that had a head who claimed to be God and claimed to be Allah, subhanallah. And we discussed yesterday how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a product of his core self. Not a product of nurture and not a product of nature, right? He was a product of his core self, right? He wasn't a product of his environment, as the philosophers say, nurture. Nor was he a product of science, nature. He was a product of his core self, for he never was misguided. He never prostrated to idols. He never consumed alcohol. He never supported the burying of females alive. He never supported circumambulating the Kaaba whilst naked. He never supported the tweaking of the Hajj. He was a product of his core self. And we know today how we are a creation of imitation. We imitate, we imitative. Not imitation, but rather we imitative by nature. We imitative by nature. We follow and copy and emulate and simulate those around us. And we know this from our little kids, right? When they get to the age of 2 and we see them doing things that we do. Right, Brother Azhar? Yes. Right? We see them doing things that we do, subhanallah. And we look at them and say, subhanallah, that's me, that's just a mini-me. It's just a mini-me. It's how we sit, we see them sitting like that. Right? How we dress, we see them dressing like that. Right? They imitate us. Right? So imagine how in touch Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with his natural disposition, his fitrah. And how in touch with his fitrah Ibrahim alayhi salam was. That even though they lived in environments of shirk and disbelief and complete misguidance, they remained steadfast and upright. They were the breath of fresh air amidst confusion and destruction. La ilaha illallah. And we all bore witness, O servants of Allah, and O children of Adam, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before we were born. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or as our scholars teach us, we lived through, or we will live through many worlds. There's the world of the souls. And there's the world of the womb of our mother. And then there's the world of this life that we are experiencing now, which means we've gone through three worlds. And then there's the world of the grave and the barzakh. And then there's the world of the day of Qiyamah and the year after. The year after, right? The perpetual life, right? And that's why the day of Qiyamah is called Qiyamah. Qiyamah refers to a day which has no day after it. Because the day after it never ends, it's perpetual, right? So, in the world of the souls, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as is mentioned in the Sahih, when He created Adam alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused all the progeny of Adam to come out of Adam. And souls came out and took their rightful place to the right and to the left. And Adam alayhi salam asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is this? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is your progeny. The progeny of the hellfire, or those that will end up in the hellfire from your progeny. And the progeny of the people of paradise, those that will end up in paradise. Allah knew, because the qadr is built upon the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah's knowledge is not confined to past tense and present tense and future tense like yourself and myself. Right? Allah knows everything that will happen. And Allah knows everything that has happened. And Allah knows everything that is happening. And Allah knows everything that will not happen. And Allah knows how everything will happen. And Allah knows that those things that are not meant to happen and will not happen, if they happen to happen, then how they will happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows this as well. Allahu Akbar. This is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this qadr is built on this knowledge. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew the life that each and every one of us will live. He knew whether we will pass his tests or whether we will fail his tests. And he knew which person from us will live upon tawheed and diligence with regards to the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whom from amongst us won't. So he explained to Adam alayhi salam, this is your progeny. Those that will enter the hellfire and those that will enter paradise. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set a question amongst each and every one of us, as is found in Surah Al-A'raf, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ Am I not your Lord? قَالُوا بَلَى And every one of us said, yes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, شَهِدْنَا Witness has taken place. أَن تَقُولُوا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ Against you saying on the day of Qiyamah, إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ That we were with regards to you being our Lord from the ignorant. We didn't know. There's no room for this now. Right? So our natural disposition naturally leans towards the witness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our Rabb. And naturally leans towards Tawheed and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oneness in His Lordship and oneness in His worship. And oneness in his attributes and names and qualities, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this natural disposition exists amongst all of us. But what is amazing is how in touch with his natural disposition Ibrahim alayhi salam was. Right? And when we look at this debate that he had with Namrud and the other aspects we will discuss just now, we cannot help but be amazed. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him with the title, Khalilullah. The one who is so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khalilullah. So close. So close. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with him in Jannah. I'm sure many of us are thinking now that we wish we have a son so we can name him Ibrahim. And by Allah, we can talk about the other anbiya alayhim as-salatu wa salam, and you will wish you have sons to name them the names of the prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose amongst mankind. Their lives are amazing. And wallahi, when we read about them and when we study them, our iman cannot help but become vitalized. Allahu Akbar. Ibrahim alayhi salam, O servants of Allah and O children of Adam, was so honorable that the nations before us fought over him. Thus the Jews said, Ibrahim is from us. And the Christians claimed attribution to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Meaning when we say Ibrahim is from us, we know that Ibrahim was before them, but they were claiming Ibrahim alayhi salam. They were claiming Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is the honor of this man, that even the previous nations fought over him. And the Christians stood up and said, no, we have an attribution and claim to Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala corrected both parties in his book and said, مَا كَانَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ يَهُودِيًّا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًّا وَلَكِنْ كَانَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ibrahim was not a Jew. Nor was he a Christian. But he was an upright, steadfast, submitted to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muslim. Remember we discussed this terminology Islam yesterday? For those who were present? Right? He was an upright, steadfast Muslim. A person who submitted to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every moment that he lived in. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ تَقُولُونَ إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَاعِيلَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ وَالْأَسْبَاطَ كَانُوا هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا قُلْ أَأَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ أَمِ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, or do they say, or do you say, indeed Ibrahim and Ismail and Ishaq and Ya'qub and the Asbaat. And the scholars differ with regards to the Asbaat. Some say they were the other children of Ya'qub alayhi salam. Do you say they were Jews and Christians? Allah says, tell them, are you more knowledgeable? Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that Ibrahim alayhi salam was an upright, steadfast Muslim. But the point is, he was so honorable that previous nations fought over him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught the world in its entirety that the only ones who have a right to claim attribution to Ibrahim alayhi salam, to claim him, are those who
إِنَّ أَوْلَى النَّاسِ بِإِبْرَاهِيمَ لَلَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُ وَهَذَا النَّبِيُّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, indeed, the forerunners with regards to Ibrahim alayhi salam are those who follow the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those who follow this Prophet, the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yourself and myself, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Alhamdulillahi alladhi hadana lihada, wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. Allah has blessed us by giving us claim to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. Again, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with him in Jannah. Ameen. So we can sit with him and discuss with him how amazed we were at the life that he lived. Ameen. Ya Rabbal Alameen. My dear brothers and sisters, as Ibrahim alayhi salam was honored with this amazing title Khalilullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us in his book that he was also described and given other titles besides Khalilullah. And from these titles is the title of Mustafa, the chosen one. Ibrahim alayhi salam was given the title of the chosen one. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in his book,
إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحًا وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَآلَ عِمْرَانَ عَلَى الْآلَمِينَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose Adam and chose Nuh and chose Ibrahim and the family of Ibrahim as well as the family of Imran over Alameen, over all of creation. Allahu Akbar. So from his titles was that he was the chosen one. And from the titles of Ibrahim alayhi salam was that he was the favored one, or the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showered upon him a completed favor. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Yusuf says,
وَيُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَىٰ آلِ يَعْقُوبَ كَمَا أَتَمَّهَا كَمَا أَتَمَّهَا عَلَىٰ أَبَوَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ.
Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Ya'qub alayhi salam teaching Yusuf alayhi salam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to complete his favor upon you, just as he completed his favor upon your forefathers, the family of Ya'qub, as well as the forefathers of Yusuf alayhi salam, who? Ibrahim wa Ishaq. Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ishaq. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Alimul Hakim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions here the teaching of Ya'qub alayhi salam to his son Yusuf alayhi salam. And at the end of this ayah, Ya'qub teaches him that your Rabb, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is Alim, all knowledgeable, and Hakim, all wise. So from the titles of Ibrahim is the one who was given a completed favor by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one point I want to mention here, and this is through tadabbur. Through tadabbur. And again, I remind you to our sitting together in January when we discussed tadabbur and this contemplation over the ayat in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this ayah which I've just recited, which is in Surah Yusuf, around the 6th ayah or the 7th ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that Ya'qub alayhi salam taught Yusuf alayhi salam that whatever difficulty you go through, it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completing His favor upon you, just as He completed His favor upon the family of Ya'qub and Ibrahim and Ishaq. Ibrahim and Ishaq. Now, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention Ibrahim before Ishaq? When Ishaq was the grandfather of Yusuf, and Ibrahim was the great-grandfather of Yusuf, right? Right? One would think that Ishaq would be mentioned before Ibrahim. But Allah mentions Ibrahim before Ishaq. And the reason why I'm mentioning this is because it has relevance to our topic as we discuss the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam, or some lessons from Ibrahim alayhi salam and his life. Right? The scholars say that this is because of the station and precedence and rank and honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Ibrahim alayhi salam, that no prophet will be mentioned before him. Allah will mention him before others, thus gave him taqdeem and brought him before Ishaq because of the love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had for the tawheed of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. The Quran is amazing, wallahi. The Quran is amazing. We have lessons in the ayat which we read, and there's lessons behind these ayat. These ayat have secrets that if we pondered, we would extrapolate and deduce with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah open our hearts and make us people of tadabbur. Ameen. From the titles of Ibrahim alayhi salam was that Allah titled him the truthful one. Thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Maryam, a surah which we love, He says, وَاذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ صِدِّيقًا نَبِيًّا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and mention in the book Ibrahim, Ibrahim alayhi salam, indeed he was an honest and truthful prophet. From the titles which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him was the title of forbearance and the title of being a supplicator and a title of being humble and the title of being repentant. Allahu Akbar. These titles which we need to aspire to have in our lives. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding this, Inna Ibrahima lahaleemun awwahum muneeb. Allahu Akbar. That verily Ibrahim alayhi salam was without doubt forbearing and used to invoke Allah with humility and was repentant to Allah all the time, again and again. This was Ibrahim alayhi salam. This was Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this whole quality of being humble is prevalent in the story in the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us about the angels, Jibreel alayhi salam and those angels that came with him that visited Ibrahim alayhi salam. They visited him on their way to Lut and the people of Lut. They were going to punish the people of Lut with a mass punishment. But they had an errand to run before that. And that was to go to the house of Ibrahim alayhi salam and give him glad tidings of a child, Ishaq. Give him glad tidings of a child, Ishaq alayhi salam. And when they visited him, from the qualities of Ibrahim was that he was generous. Allahu Akbar. We can bring out qualities after quality after quality after quality. He was an embodiment of the best of character. Right? So Ibrahim was also a generous person. Thus he presented to them a calf, because they say the wealth of Ibrahim alayhi salam or his property was cows, was cows. So he presented to them an entire calf, cooked and ready to be consumed, but they did not partake of the meal. So he pushed it towards them and said, "Ala ta'kulun? Do you not eat?" And then they revealed themselves as messengers from Allah who have been sent to Lut. Now look at the humbleness of this man. Immediately when he understood that they are going to destroy the people of Lut, immediately look at this humble, forbearing man. These were from his qualities. His character came out. And immediately he said, "Inna fiha Luta." That why are you going there when Lut is there? Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. He is defending his brother. And the angels responded, "Nahnu a'lamu biman fiha." We are more knowledgeable about who's there. We are more knowledgeable about who's there. And they mentioned the punishment that's going to overcome this nation besides Lut and the family of Lut, except his wife, for she would be from the ones who would experience the punishment as well. But look at Ibrahim. That, you know, here guests come, and it's not his business to worry about the people of Lut and these angels that Allah has sent to them. But he makes it his business. Allahu Akbar. Because of how soft he is, and how generous he was, and how forbearing he was, and how humble he was. La ilaha illallah. Today, I ask you, by Allah, if we knew that some form of harm was coming to our competition, in business, would we defend our competitor? Or would we say, "Subhana Rabbi al-A'la," and start working out our profits for the next month? Even in da'wah, O servants of Allah, and O children of Adam, how have we become that even in da'wah we are envious of other Islamic organizations? We are envious of our other Muslim brothers and sisters who are doing work in the da'wah. Allahu Akbar. Was Ibrahim was a prophet, and Lut was a prophet. But was he, they were doing the same da'wah. They were doing the same da'wah. But Ibrahim alayhi salam had a vision, and that vision was tawheed in this dunya. And Lut alayhi salam had a vision, and that vision was tawheed in this dunya. And a people who lived their lives diligent to the kalimah la ilaha illallah. So they shared the same vision. Thus they were partners and not competitors. Ibrahim saw this as my partner, as somebody who's helping me achieve my vision. Thus he immediately forgot about the food that wasn't being eaten, and immediately started defending his partner and his brother, Lut alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. What amazing lessons we learn from this great prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, Khalilullah. And again we say, may Allah gather us with him in Jannah. Ameen. So this was from the titles of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And from his titles was that he was a prophet that was guided from a very young age. He was guided from a very young age. This is another title which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. The one who was guided from a young age. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ رُشْدَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَكُنَّا بِهِ عَالِمِينَ.
Allahu Akbar. Allah says that indeed we gave Ibrahim alayhi salam his guidance from before, and we were with regards to him knowledgeable. These are the titles, O servants of Allah and O children of Adam. And this is this amazing man. And that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, as is in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, from the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, that the first person to be clothed on the day of Qiyamah, will be Ibrahim alayhi salam. And yes, he is deserving of this. For wallahi, he was a nation. We just discussed how he was a giant in many segments. And we've just discussed the many titles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. And by Allah, what I have said about him thus far is only a drop in the ocean or a tip of the iceberg. He was an entire nation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared him to be an entire nation. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nahl,
إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً قانتا لله حنيفا ولم يك من المشركين شاكرا لأنعمه اجتباه وهداه إلى صراط مستقيم وآتيناه في الدنيا حسنة وَإِنَّهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ لَمِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ.
Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily, indeed, Ibrahim was an entire ummah. La ilaha illallah. An entire nation. He was one man, but he was enough. Today we want numbers. We gauge the size of our organization, or size of our talk, or size of our country, based on the populace and population. We obsessed with great numbers, with quantity, right? Even the GDP, it has to be a grand GDP, and with GDP it must be. It must be. But sometimes we make it grand based on false premise. On false premise, we absorbed with quantity. Allah says, be a person of quality. That Ibrahim was one man living in a nation of shirk, living in a nation of idolatry. His father was upon it. His family was upon it. But he denied it. One man. Allah said he was an entire nation. La ilaha illallah. An entire nation. That's quality, O servants of Allah. And that's quality, O children of Adam. And this is how we appreciate those 313 or so, plus or minus, on Badr. On Badr. That Allah used as a means for us to be Muslims today, for us to sit here in this gathering and celebrate the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. Quality over quantity. This is Ibrahim. He was an ummah, a leader, having all the good righteous qualities, and a nation. These are the different interpretations of, explanations rather, of the scholars of tafsir. He was obedient to Allah. He was upright, hanifa. And he wasn't from the mushrikun, the polytheists. Allah says, شَاكِرًا لِعَنْؤُمِهِ. He was thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these gifts that Allah gave him. And we discussed the importance of being thankful. And Allah says that Allah chose him as an intimate friend, خَلِيل, Allahu Akbar, and guided him to a straight path. And Allah says, and we gave him good in this world, and in the hereafter, he shall be of the righteous. May Allah give us good in this world, and make us from the righteous in the hereafter. Ameen. 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 Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we continue discussing the blessings of Ibrahim alayhi salam, O servants of Allah, and O children of Adam, Allah teaches us that from the titles of Ibrahim was that he was the father of prophethood and revelation. La ilaha illallah. Imagine having that title, O servants of Allah. Imagine having that title, O children of Adam, to be the father of prophethood and revelation. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hadid,
وَجَعَلْنَا فِي ذُرِّيَّتِهِمَا النُّبُوَّةَ وَالْكِتَابِ.
Allah says that we placed in his progeny prophethood and revelation. And we discussed this yesterday, that from the blessings of Ibrahim alayhi salam and how Allah loved him and how pleased he made Allah, Allahu Akbar, Allah declared that every prophet that will enter this world after him will be from his family. Will be from his family. For Ibrahim had two sons named Ishaq and Ismail, or Ismail and Ishaq. And the scholars of tafsir say, or some say, that Ismail was given to Ibrahim when he was 90 years old, and some say 95, and some have given other figures. And Ishaq was given to him at the age of 100. And every prophet after these two sons were from the progeny of Ibrahim alayhi salam. For Ishaq had a son called Ya'qub. And Ya'qub was titled Israel. Israel, and that's why we have the story of Banu Israel. And Ishaq had children. And every prophet after Ishaq goes to Ibrahim alayhi salam through Ishaq alayhi salam. Except one prophet. And that was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who goes to Ibrahim via Ismail alayhi salam. Via Ismail alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Ibrahim Ismail through Hajar alayhi salam. And gave Ibrahim Ishaq through Sarah alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Ibrahim Ismail through Hajar alayhi salam. And gave Ibrahim Ishaq through Sarah alayhi salam. And Ibrahim was commanded to take Hajar and Ismail to the barren land. And thus we celebrate the life of Ibrahim in our Umrah and Hajj. The Zamzam, the Maqam of Ibrahim, the Safa and Marwa, the pelting of the Shayateen. Right? SubhanAllah, look how Allah loved this. Look at the barakah of this man. That an entire pillar in Islam has been revealed in recognition of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Wallahi, what will make us understand who is Ibrahim alayhi salam? That Allah makes us after Arafah go and pelt. And on the days of Tashriq, go and pelt. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Not once, but a second day. And a third day. And a fourth day. We have the 3 days of Tashriq, and then we have the pelting of the greater Jamarah on the day of Eid. Imagine. Simple pelting. Why? Because a great man who walked this earth before you and I, he did this and it was beloved to Allah. There were devils that were trying to throw him off, carrying out the command of Allah. And this is what he did. And Allah loved it. Thus emulated. Allah loves to see that act happen time and time again. Thus he made it a pillar or part of the pillar of the pillars of Islam. Hajj. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, my hairs are standing just talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam and just thinking about this. Imagine us in this world, and the most amazing person, your hero, the person you would love to meet, he praises you by name. And he introduces an act that is dedicated to you. How honored and how special would you feel? Imagine that. And the Lord of the worlds has recognized a man and set as a practice an action that celebrates the action of this man and recognizes him. So how special must he be? Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Again we say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with him in Jannah. Ameen. 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 So this is it, O servants of Allah. Allah placed in his progeny prophethood, Nubuwwah and revelation. For all these prophets came from his progeny and books were revealed to them. Thus, these books and these prophets were in the progeny of Ibrahim alayhi salam. What an amazing person indeed. What an amazing person indeed. And that is why when someone told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, oh best of mankind, ya khayr al bariyah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, no, the best of mankind is Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. And that's why he's been given these titles. He's been given these titles. And for your information, for those who want to follow up, this particular hadith is the hadith of Anas ibn Malik. It's the hadith of Anas ibn Malik and is found in Sahih Muslim. Sahih Muslim. And we just shared earlier the hadith of Ibn Abbas. How Ibrahim alayhi salam will be the first to be clothed on the day of Qiyamah. So his blessings continue from this world into the hereafter. My dear brothers and sisters, wallahi, I mean, we need, rightfully the talk should end now. We've completed over an hour. And honestly, to sit and discuss the history of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the many events that happened in his life and the many lessons that can be deduced from these events, we would require, I would say, 2 days. 2 days together. Maybe 10 hours on one day and 10 hours on the next day. In fact, maybe we should make this a course. MashaAllah, I see the brothers here, they have their folders for the Al-Kawthar course that they're attending here at Al-Fanar, mashaAllah. May Allah bless them for their striving. They've sat the whole day today for almost 10 hours, and they're sitting for this program. Walillahi alhamd. May Allah bless you all, and increase your knowledge, and make you ulama of the ummah, and make from your children ulama as well. Ameen, ameen. And perhaps this can be a course, wallahi, just to sit down and better our lives from studying the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. But with your permission, if you permit, I would like to read some ayat from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that describes one event, or the earliest event in the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and that is him in the house of his father, in the house of idolatry, and a conversation that takes place between them, and three or four lessons that we can deduce with your permission. Because we wouldn't complete this talk if we didn't at least take an incident from his life and learn from it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his book says,
وَاذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ صِدِّيقًا نَبِيًّا إِذْ قَالَ لِأَبِيهِ يَا أَبَتِ لِمَ تَعْبُدُ مَا لَا يَسْمَعُ وَلَا يُبْصِرُ وَلَا يُغْنِي عَنْكَ شَيْئًا يَا أَبَتِ إِنِّي قَدْ جَاءَنِي مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مَا لَمْ يَأْتِكَ فَاتَّبِعْنِي أَهْدِكَ صِرَاطًا سَوِيًّا يا أبت لا تعبد الشيطان إن الشيطان كان للرحمن عصيا يا أبت إني أخاف أن يمسك عذاب إني أخاف أن يمسك عذاب من الرحمن فتكون للشيطان وليا قال أراغب أنت عن آلهتي يا إبراهيم لئن لم تنته لأرجمنك واهجرني مليا قال سلام عليك سأستغفر لك ربي إنه كان بي حفيا وأعتزلكم وما تدعون من دون الله وأدعو ربي عسى ألا أكون بدعاء ربي شقيا فلما اعتزلهم وما يعبدون من دون الله وهبنا له إسحاق ويعقوب وكلا جعلنا نبيا وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِنَا وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُمْ لِسَانَ صِدْقٍ عَلِيًّا.
The Quran is beautiful, wallahi. It's soothing. It's soothing. It's therapeutic. As we say, we take peace from it and contentment from it. And especially when you understand it. Let us go through these ayat. In the 19th chapter, or more appropriately, surah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ And mention in the book the story of Ibrahim. I'm going to run through this quickly. Indeed, he was a man of truth and a prophet. And mention when he said to his father, Oh my dear father, why do you worship that which does not hear and does not see and will not benefit you at all? Oh my dear father, indeed there has come to me of knowledge that which has not come to you. So follow me, and I will guide you to an even path. Oh, my dear father, do not worship shaitan. Indeed, shaitan has ever been to the most merciful disobedient. Allahu Akbar. Look at the advice of a young to the one who is old. Oh, my dear father, indeed I fear that they will touch you a punishment from the most merciful. So you would be to shaitan a companion in the hellfire. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So his father heard him and said to him, have you no desire for my gods, O Ibrahim? If you do not desist, meaning from saying what you're saying, I will surely stone you. So avoid me and get away from me for a prolonged time. So he was scolded and he was scorned. And Ibrahim turns to his father and says, قال سلام عليك. Peace be upon you. سأستغفر لك ربي. I will ask forgiveness for you from my Lord. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. إنه كان بي حفيا. Indeed, he is ever gracious to me. Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, how many of us value our Islam and our Iman? By Allah, have we ever thanked Allah for waking up with this greatest gift, Islam, and this greatest gift, Iman? Have we ever thanked Allah? By Allah, I ask you, have you ever thanked Allah, literally cried to Allah and said, Ya Allah, wallahi, you gave me the greatest gift without me ever asking you for it? Have we ever? Look at Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibrahim alayhi salam says, and I will leave you and those you invoke other than Allah. And I will invoke my Allah and my Lord. I expect that I will not be in invocation to my Lord unhappy. So when he had left them and those they worshipped other than Allah, we gave him Ishaq and we gave him Ya'qub from the progeny of Ishaq, and each of them we made a prophet. And we gave them our mercy, Allahu Akbar. And we made for them a reputation of high honor. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Maryam, in the ayat that I chose to recite for you. Brothers and sisters, before we leave, let us traverse through these ayat together. Let us traverse very quickly through these ayat together, and at least through tadabbur, extrapolate some lessons. For Ibrahim alayhi salam and his life is deserving of us doing this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us from these ayat, brothers and sisters, that charity begins at home. Because Allah tells us in this portion of the Quran how Ibrahim alayhi salam is giving da'wah to his father first. Not to anyone else in the community, to his father first. Charity begins at home. Today, brothers and sisters, we are quick to look at the faults of others. And we don't see the problems that need fixing right in front of us. I'm not saying that da'wah should not be comprehensive. It should be. But da'wah should also be prioritized. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to begin this da'wah by inviting the close ones. وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. Start with your close ones, your relatives, and those in close proximity to you. Charity begins at home. This is what we learn first and foremost from the outset of this conversation between Ibrahim alayhi salam and his father. What an amazing da'i Ibrahim alayhi salam was. We just said at the beginning that he was a giant in da'wah. Right? He was a giant in da'wah. Those closest to us, brothers and sisters, they have a greater right to our goodness than those who are further from us. And when Islam teaches us to maintain family relations, it's not just about visiting people. It's not just about visiting people. It's about being proactive with them. This is how you maintain family relations. This is how it is. That you are proactive with them. That you are first to correct their mistakes for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If there's a mistake, you don't go about speaking behind their back about their mistake. This is how da'wah is done. to those in close proximity to us. And this is the da'wah of Ibrahim. He's not speaking to anyone else about his father. He's immediately visiting his father and teaching his father and inviting his father, alayhi salam, alayhi salam. Today, sadly, our relationship with our families and close ones is in a total opposite direction to Ibrahim alayhi salam and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about him here. And it's totally opposite to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have a petty attitude in maintaining relationships with our families. We have the attitude, if they visit me, I will visit them. That's our attitude. Right? Their daughter got married. They didn't invite me to their walima. Wait, I'm going to fix him. I have three daughters. I have three. Right? I'm going to fix him. This is our attitude. This is our attitude. This is not the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the Anbiya alayhi salatu was salam and the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not the way of a Muslim who has submitted to the will of Allah and declared Allah as one and accepted the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A Muslim lives his or her life upon the character of Islam and not the character of another person. If your values is to greet people, you will greet them every day, even if they don't greet you back. Because you will continue being who you are. This is you looking, these are the values that Islam has instilled in us. And the values that we need to strive to upkeep. And by Allah, the moment we lose these values, we will lose ourselves. Ibrahim alayhi salam is teaching us the importance of value. The importance of value. May Allah grant us the understanding. Many of us are slaves. Slaves of our own emotions. Our own emotions. We just discussed how Ibrahim was supportive of Lut. Today, somebody else has something, we are envious. We become slaves of our own emotions. Right? We don't work with them with the character of Islam. We work with them with other people's character. And thus we become sad people and depressed people. And people who shorten their lives. Why? Because there's stress. And we know that stress has spiritual and physical harm. It has. It increases our blood pressure from the physical harms. Right? Whereby if we took a page from the Anbiya alayhi salatu wassalam, we would celebrate the success of somebody else using the character and the values of Islam, and we would free ourselves from being a slave to the emotion of hasad and envy and jealousy and so on and so forth. These qualities of shaitan that made shaitan become wretched and doomed forever. Try it one day. Somebody has something that you would love. Celebrate it as if you were given that thing. And see how well you sleep at night. Try it one day. Try it one day. Celebrate it as if you received it. Because he's your Muslim brother. And the character of Islam dictates that we behave this way. And this is better for our dunya and akhirah. May Allah grant us the understanding. So, point number one. Charity begins at home. Look after your family members. Comprehensively. In visiting them, yes. And in our da'wah. And activeness and proactiveness with them. May Allah grant us the understanding. Ameen. The second point we learn from the da'wah of Ibrahim alayhi salam is politeness in speech. How many times did you hear, oh my dear father, ya abati. 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 Allahu Akbar. How many times did you hear that just now in these ayat that we recited? His father was upon misguidance. But look at the patience. Look at the respect. Look at Ibrahim alayhi salam. We were just discussing how forbearing and humble. He had, this was Ibrahim. Because this story is telling us about Ibrahim as a young boy. He was much younger than when the angels visited him before they went to Lut. And even here, his qualities are the same. His qualities are the same. The character of Islam existed. He wasn't a person who in one portion of his life had a certain character. And in another portion of his life had a different character. A person who lost his identity. No. You know, they always say today, identity crisis. Our youth are going through an identity crisis. They never went through identity crises. They knew who they were, they knew where they came from, they knew where they were going, and they knew how to get there successfully. They had their values, they were people of perspective. People of perspective. So he's speaking to his father in the mildest of ways. Today, by Allah, how do we address our children when they make mistakes? What words come out of our mouth? Allahu musta'an. That our child might remember that word in old age and it will give them a low self-esteem. Because of our crime and no fault of theirs. Today, even in our da'wah, sometimes how do we see people addressing other people that they want to correct? Oh innovator, oh misguided one, oh mubtadir, and so on and so forth. Allahul musta'an. Look at Ibrahim alayhi salam talking to an idolater. He's saying, my dear father, the softest of speech, the softest of speech. And the scholars of the Arabic language say that there are 10 ways to call your mother and father in the Arabic language. The softest of these 10 is Ya Abati with the Ta. And this was the sunnah of all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For we see this in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam when he went to his father and also said, Ya Abati. And subhanallah, we see that these children, these young, they addressed their parents with the respect gained from the way the parents addressed them. Because the parents would address their children, or the Anbiya alayhim salatu wassalam, they would address their children in the most sweetest of ways as well. Have we not seen in the Quran, Ya Bunay, oh my dear son, Ya Bunay, oh my dear son. Even in the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam, look how he was. Look how he was. When he was older, and Allah tested him with Ismail. Because Allah loved his tawheed. And Ibrahim was making dua for years and years and years. Ya Allah, grant me a child, grant me a child, grant me a child. So when Allah gave him Ismail, Allah tested him. That who is more beloved to you? Allah and his command or your son Ismail. Thus Allah commanded him to put a knife to his neck. Right? When Allah commanded him to this act, Ibrahim alayhi salam turned to his son. And Allah tells us this in the Quran. Allah says, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعْيَ قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. Allah says that once it was understood what was required of him, he turned to his son and he said, oh my dear son, indeed I see in a dream myself slaughtering you. So what do you say about this? Oh my dear son, what do you say about this? And Ismail alayhi salam turns to his father and says, قَالَ يَا أَبَاتِ. Oh my dear father, اِفْعَلْ مَا تُؤْمَرْ. Carry out that which Allah has commanded you to do. سَتَجِدُنِي. You will find me. إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ. With the permission of Allah and the will of Allah. مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ. From the patient. May Allah make us diligent parents and make us diligent children, and may Allah grant us diligence in our speech and da'wah. Ameen. Ameen. So that's the second point. To be sweet in our da'wah. To be sweet in our da'wah. Speak to people with kindness. Speak to them with respect. Speak to them with respect. Repel evil with good. Allahu Akbar. Even if they speak against you, repel that with goodness. And this is the third point that I want to share with you from the da'wah of Ibrahim. Because when his father spoke to him harshly and said, if you don't stop, I will stone you and get away from me. Right? Right? This is what his father in effect said. What did Ibrahim alayhi salam say? What did he say? He said, Salamun alayk. He repelled that evil with goodness. With that which is ahsan and better. If somebody called you names, address them with sweetness. Repel that evil with goodness. And this is the third lesson from the ayat which we read. Ibrahim alayhi salam teaches us How to maintain our values and maintain our akhlaq and maintain our character. My father just scolded me. He told me to get away. He threatened to stone me. How scared must I feel? But immediately I will still never lose my values with regards to me and my father. Thus he says, Salamun alaik. Peace be upon you. And not only that, I will be good to my father. سَأَسْتَغْفِرُ لَكَ رَبِّي. I will ask Allah to forgive you. Allahu Akbar. He wants to be dutiful to his father. And yes, Ibrahim did seek forgiveness until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him that his father is destined for the hellfire. Thus, Ibrahim alayhi salam had to stop. And he stopped seeking forgiveness from that point onwards. From that point onwards. This is the third lesson, brothers and sisters. No pettiness. Repel evil with goodness. And this is from the highest stages of a person's character and belief. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this in the Quran. The ability to make your enemy your greatest friend and supporter. He says, "Idfa billati hiya ahsan, faidha alladhi baynaka wa baynahu adawa ka'annahu waliyyun hamim." Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. That repel that evil with that which is better. So that perhaps you will convert your enemy and make him your greatest supporter. Allahu Akbar. Right? This is from the lessons of Ibrahim alayhi salam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with him in Jannah. There are many, many lessons I would like to share. But inshallah, this is a good reason for us to agree to inshallah make dua that Allah gathers us again together to learn from the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. From the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. We can't do everything. We can't do everything, but we've done something. And inshallah, we've done a lot. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Inshallah, we've learned about this great prophet. And as you learn about him, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us like him. Ask Allah to inspire us to be like him. So Allah loves us in a greater way. In a greater way. That we do those deeds that are a means of earning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's greater love. Greater love. Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with Ibrahim alayhi salam in Jannah. And may Allah inspire us to have sittings dedicated to the lessons from the events in the life of this Prophet and the other Anbiya alayhimus salatu was salam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspire us to emulate His way and the ways of the Anbiya alayhimus salatu was salam in our lives. Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with Him in Jannah. Ameen. I love you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have a farewell topic tomorrow because I leave Qatar and you all after that topic. And that topic is also titled Lessons from the Khutbah of the Farewell Hajj. Right? So we have a farewell topic related to the farewell Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve us in His obedience and grant us life to avail ourselves tomorrow bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. And as we agreed yesterday, when you come, bring two people with you because you have two hands, and make sure they bring two people as well because they have two hands. Barakallahu feekum. Hatha wallahu a'lam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.